And now, the show that's all about baseball.
That's when the game, to me, is at its best.
This is the Baseball Hour with Tony Mass.
Brought to you by Bigelow Tea, KM Hot Dogs, I Promise, official eye vitamin of the Boston Red Sox, Gravely Zero Turn Lawnmowers, and Window World.
On Boston's home for sports, 98.5, the Sports Hub.
Durant extends, 2-2, is called strike three. Devers goes down looking, and the Tigers take the first one of the series against the Red Sox by a final score of 4-2. Well, the losing streak is at 5 after this one here in Detroit.
5 in a row. Red Sox have lost 5 in a row. In first place for the large majority of this baseball season in the American League East. Now they've lost 5 straight, their longest losing streak of the year. Another one last night to the Detroit Tigers after being swept by the Tampa Bay Rays, and so they are where they are. Meanwhile, the Yankees win again. Blue Jays win again. The Rays lose, but the wall's literally closing in on your Boston Red Sox. So here's what we're going to do tonight. We'll open up the phone lines right away. Billy Lanny is in for Jimmy Stewart. So, Billy, open up the phone, 617-779-0985. I want to begin with 2 topics tonight, one of which still relates to the Major League trading deadline, but we'll get to that in one moment. If you're watching these Red Sox games, you watch the Tampa series, you watch last night, and again, the Detroit Tigers, I warned you yesterday, I said Detroit's been playing better. The Tigers are 11-6 in their last 17 going into last night. They're now 12-6. In their last 18, they beat the Red Sox 4-2 was your final score, despite the fact that the Red Sox actually had an early lead in that game. Murray, if I were to say to you, or ask you, and I ask our listeners out there as well, right now, tell me why the Red Sox are losing, what would your answer be? And I'll leave it open-ended. Go ahead.
I think it's because the offense has dried up. More than anything else, right now, this 5-game losing streak, but especially the sweep at the hands of the Rays and what you saw last night against Detroit, it's because guys like J.D. Martinez and Verdugo have looked very bad and kind of lost at the plate in situations where you need a big hit late in the game from them. Like, collectively, like, their offense, they still have the ability to put up 7 runs in a game at any point, but right now, they've dried up in clutch situations. I think it's the offense more than anything else during this 5-game losing streak.
Billy Lanny, you have an opinion on that? If I were to ask you, is it the pitching? Is it the offense? What would you say?
I'm always going to blame offense.
Okay. See, I think most people focus on the pitching, and they say they can't pitch. Cal Richards on the mound, or these guys can't go 4 or 5 innings, and they can't pitch. And they're right, they can't. I mean, the Red Sox pitching has been suspect all year long. But if you look at the way the Red Sox were built this year, they were built to win how? And to Murray's point, they were built to win by scoring. It's an offensive team. It was since day one. They were frugal on the pitching staff. They've tried to patch it together, in many cases, with duct tape and bailing wire.
But it's an offense that's built to win games 6-4, 7-5, ultimately.
Okay, so the last 2 games, they've given up 4 runs and 3 runs, and they've lost them both. As bad as Garrett Richards has been, last night, the pitching staff gave up 4 runs. The night before to Tampa, they gave up 3. They lost both games, which brings me to this. And I think this is an important stat. It's not foolproof. There is no stat that is. But this one does tell you a lot, at least this year, and I think oftentimes does. The Red Sox this year, when they score 3 runs or fewer, are 7-37.
Jesus.
Now, I know what you're thinking. Yeah, Maz, every team loses when they don't score 4 runs. True. Absolutely true. Every team does lose. The best team in baseball this year is 14-27 when scoring 3 or fewer. So the point is, it's absolutely correct. Even if you're the best in the game when you don't score, when you score a minimal amount.
But that doesn't seem as out of whack as where the Red Sox are.
Okay, so Murray,
only 7 wins.
So this is the point. It's about the ranking. It's about the ranking and how you rank in low-scoring games when you get 3 or fewer. So, for example, I said to you, the best record in baseball this year when scoring 3 or fewer, 14-27. That's a winning percentage of .341. But you know who has it? San Francisco Giants. You know who's second best in that category? Los Angeles Dodgers. Third best? Yankees. Fifth best? San Diego. Sixth best, Tampa. Houston 7th. The White Sox are 8th. Oakland is 10th. So of the 10 teams who have the best winning percentage when they don't score, 8 of them are playoff teams, basically, or playoff contenders. The Yankees are borderline. But you get the idea. 8 of them, including the Giants, the Dodgers, the Padres, the Rays, the Astros, the White Sox, and the A's. I think those are the best teams in baseball. I think those teams are the best teams in the game. And so, in defense of the Red Sox, and I'll get to them too in a minute because I hate what they did at the deadline. When we say, well, what's the difference between the Red Sox and the Giants both coming out of the woodwork? And you know what the answer is? The Giants can pitch. And the Giants can win now in more ways than the Red Sox can. So that is your difference. Now, that said, oh, I still hate the deadline. Still hate it. Can't stand it. I cannot stand what the Red Sox did at the deadline. And this relates to Garrett Richards last night. And I don't know why I didn't think about this sooner. I should have connected the dots earlier and I didn't. And shame on me for that. And that is that Garrett Richards last night was obviously boxed around again, left the game in the fifth inning without recording an out. And you know what? The Red Sox paid him $10 million. He was their biggest signing of the offseason. And when I started looking at it this morning, I said, who could they have signed instead of Garrett Richards? I came up with Taijuan Walker, who signed with the Mets for 3 years, and I think it was about $23, $24 million, somewhere in that area. It was around $8 million a year. The other one I came up with was Carlos Rodon with the Chicago White Sox, who was non-tendered and became a free agent and then re-signed for $3 million. $3 million. The Red Sox got Garrett Richards for 10. But then I stopped and I said, oh, I'm looking at cheap guys. Like, I never even considered that they would sign Trevor Bauer. They were never going to go after a guy like that because they didn't think they were going to contend. But in retrospect, you know what else was a factor? They did not want to go over the luxury tax during the winter. During the winter, they were budgeting the team that way. And I don't know why I didn't connect the dots earlier, because I said to myself, well, of course. I thought the Red Sox would get into the regular season, see how the year went, and then say, well, if we're in it, we'll add at the deadline and we'll go over the tax if it's worth it. If the team's in it and they're worth investing in, then we'll go over the deadline. So now let me ask you, how could they have been more worth it than they were? How could the Red Sox possibly have shown more than they did to convince ownership that they were worthy of going over the tax for? They did everything they possibly could on the field, the uniformed personnel did. Everything. They could not realistically have had a better first half than they did. And the organization still wouldn't go over the tax. They still wanted to stay under that luxury tax threshold. And when you look at it in those terms, and you go back to the offseason and Garrett Richards at $10 million, and where also where they were shopping, what kinds of players they were shopping for, you know what the real truth is? There was nothing this team was going to do this year that was going to convince ownership or upper management to invest in the club and go over the tax at the deadline. Now, there's a fine line there because still, they could have done more than they did. But and the big sin is not going over the tax. It's not getting, or it's not missing out on Max Scherzer or missing out on Jose Berríos. The big sin is not going over the tax. And they never had any intention of doing it. And the message to the players was, we don't believe in you. And I said this last hour on Felger and Maz, and I'll say it now. If you are a fan of the team and you want to believe, and they are selling you or trying to sell you over the course of the season on believing, we're for real. No, we're a good team. How many times did Alex Cora say that? We're a good baseball team. He said it over and over and over.
Maz, he eventually got to a point where he said, yes, the team could go to the World Series.
So, Murray, they want you to buy their tickets. And I don't know that whether that was a deliberate attempt on Cora's part to try to sell tickets or garner fan interest. But I have to believe that part of the message that they wanted him to convey was credibility, leadership, optimism, all of that stuff. And so Cora conveyed it. I also think that Cora believed it. They are a good team. They're not a great team, but they're a good team. So they sell you all this stuff during the course of the year. As a fan, believe in us. We're for real. We're worthy of your time. We're worthy of your investment. And then the deadline comes and they won't invest in their own team. How are you supposed to take that as a fan? How are you supposed to look at that with a straight face and go, wait a minute, you want me to invest, but you won't? So this is where the Red Sox, to me, may have suffered their greatest loss at the deadline, is in the credibility with their fan base and, you know, and in keeping those people that they have won back over the first half of this year. And look, if you invested in this team on the field, you'll continue to. You'll watch it unless they play themselves out of it, which is not out of the realm of possibility, given the way they've played of late and the way the division's closing in on them. But again, they want you to believe. They want you to buy the tickets. They want you to sit on the sofa and watch the game. They want you to believe. But then the trading deadline came and the Red Sox didn't believe themselves. So, I again, that's a hard one for them to overcome. Because talk about a trump card. The next time the team tries to sell you a bag of panda poo or some bricks or whatever else that they want to sell you, you say, oh, right. But you don't believe in your own club. Not really. Because you would have extended a little more than you did at this deadline. So we'll tell you what Alex Cora said with regard to the offense, too. We'll get to that in a second. But first, Matt in Framingham, what do you got?
Tony, Matt, if I'm high in Bloom right now, I'd be scared to death. Because he just basically, along with the Red Sox front office, flipped the bird at the players. And now the concern that I have with this team going forward is that they're going to shut it down if this gets worse. And that, to me, is the troublesome part about this whole thing. They completely overachieved in the first half and were supposed to be rewarded for their hard work. And instead, what they got was they got a big, giant lump of coal from the front office. And as far as I'm concerned, if I'm Alex Cora, I am absolutely livid.
Okay, so, Matt, I'll tell you what. I think Cora knew it was coming. I think Cora knew it was coming. And Billy, I'm putting you on the spot. We'll look it up during the break. We'll find it during the break. Again, we'll play for you what Cora said right before the deadline late last week. When he was asked point blank by Alex Speer of the Globe, are you worried about the disappointment in your clubhouse if your team does nothing? Okay, we'll tell you exactly what Cora said. I also want to play for you what he said about the offense. We'll continue with your phone calls. We'll give you an update tonight on where Kyle Schwarber stands. All of that tonight on the Baseball Hour.
The show that's all about baseball. The Baseball Hour. 98.5, the Sports Hub.
Boom Boom Games, your home for 80s and 90s retro video games, wrestling figures and collectibles, vintage toys, cards, comics, and all your nostalgia needs. They've got something for every console from Atari 2600 to the PS5 and Xbox Series X. Looking for a specific video game? They will try to source it for you. Do you have some old consoles or collectibles? Bring them in, because Boom Boom Games buys and trades. Boom Boom Games is also your store for Star Wars toys, Pokemon, and the wrestling selection will have you feeling that sweet chin music. Boom Boom Games in Billerica. Check them out.
Whether it's happening on the field or off, Mass is talking about it.
What should we expect from Alex Cora's Red Sox in 2021?
The Baseball Hour on 98.5, the Sports Hub.
It's frustrating. This has been the worst year of my career. So just trying to find a way to give us a chance to win every night and take steps forward.
Gary, at this point in the year, with Chris almost coming back and Tanner being a part of the rotation, does it feel like there's a part of this where you're fighting for your life in the rotation?
Not at all. That's you guys, not me.
As you've obviously you're trying different things with regards to your pitch mix, and all that. Is, as frustrating as this has been, is it possible that there would be a benefit to a change of roles at any point?
I'm a starting pitcher. I have an ability to throw 100 pitches and keep my stuff the whole time. So I feel like that in itself is enough to keep me in the rotation. Not many people can do it.
It's Garrett Richards. I agree that not many people can be starting pitchers in the major leagues. I'm just not sure that he's one of them. How could you possibly believe that at this stage? Richards, 4 innings last night. He teetered in the fourth. K came back out, didn't get an out in the fifth. Honestly, I thought he was lucky to get out of the fourth inning. He got a guy to chase a bad pitch for a strikeout. And then the final out was a 3-1 play involving Franchy Cordero that, honestly, I thought it was a miracle the Red Sox pulled it off. For a grounder to Franchy Cordero, who had never played first base, to my knowledge anyway, before this season. Maybe I'm misrepresenting that, but he's not a first baseman. And then Richards is covering. I thought, there's no chance they make this play. And he made it. He made it. They made it, which I was stunned by. He then never got an out in the next inning. Walked the number 9 hitter, fell behind the next guy, gave up a double. That was it. So you know what the right answer is, Jim Murray, when we look at the Red Sox and say, why are they losing? Because right now they suck at everything.
That's true.
Okay, that's the right answer. When you go on a losing streak, it usually means you suck at everything. So, but I will say that when they only give up 4 runs in the process, as bad as Richards was last night, it was only 4 runs. And the game before that, they lost 3-2. When that happens, when the Red Sox allow 3 and 4 runs, they can't go 0-2. They really should go 2-0. But I'm trying to be fair and say at a minimum you're going 1-1. They went 0-2. This team has to score for them to win. They're not going to win many games 2-1, 3-2. They had one little stretch when they were hot in July, might have been end of June, where they went to Oakland and won a couple of low-scoring games. Remember that series? And that one I thought, wow, if they start winning those, look out. Because they're not built that way, and this is why they're in the funk that they are in. I want to get back to your calls, but let me just play for you again. This was Cora last night talking about the offense, and it's worth repeating because, again, I think everything is going wrong for this team, and I think we overlooked the offense. Murray hasn't. Murray's been on it by noting that they haven't scored. And at the end of the day, they were built to win games 5-4 and 6-5. That's how they were built. And now they're losing them 4-2 and 3-2.
It's those 2 through 5 hitters that, you know, were like the best part of this team for most of those, pretty much up until the All-Star break, that had just, it's dried up. Like, again, it's guys like, you know, J.D. Martinez, Renfro, Bogarts, Devers, like, especially in clutch situations, they've just dried up.
Murray, when those guys don't hit, they're boned.
Yeah, it's that simple.
Yeah, they are. They're screwed. When those guys don't hit, they're screwed. Again, they've had little stretches during the year where the bottom of the lineup hit and produce some runs for them. But we all know how they're built. The money is in the middle of the order. Okay, that's where the money is. And if the money doesn't produce, they're porked. So anyway, here's Cora last night on the offense.
We still believe in these guys. You know, we do believe that they can go 5-6 innings for us, just like they did early in the season, and put us in a good spot to win. I mean, at the end of the day, they score 4 runs. And offensively, we believe we can score more. So this is more about the offense right now and actually than the pitching. You know, they scored 3 on Saturday. We didn't find a way to win it offensively, and they scored 4 today. You know, there's, you know, 4 runs against us. We do believe that, you know, we should win those ball games.
Which is exactly what Jim Murray's point has been. And he's right. Cora sees it the same way. We give up 4, we should win that game. We give up 3, we should win that game. The last 2, they've lost them both. Tim's in Attleboro. Go ahead, Tim.
Hey, how you doing, Tony? Great show, like usual. And Jim Murray, what I wanted to bring up, which I haven't heard much, is Christian Vasquez. Like you say, we need Schwaber to come up first base. You usually get some pop out of your first baseman and your catcher. Vasquez has 4 home runs. I don't know if he's the next Tony Pena. You know a lot more than I do, but like calling a game and everything, but he has no stick at all. And I think they just brought up a guy at the end of July, but don't you think he should have, like, wouldn't you make a move with him? Like, unless he's Tony Pena calling games and stuff, but he has no stick. Oh. And usually at least your catcher has something. So I'll hang up and listen and great show like usual.
Go ahead, Murray.
He's sucked defensively this year too. How many pass balls does he have?
Good
he
question.
Might lead
I don't
the
know.
League. He's turned into a pumpkin, maybe more than anyone else on this team. And especially, like, how many times in recent years, especially when things have been going good for the Red Sox, are you getting, like, a clutch home run from Christian Vasquez? It just felt like the guy was a lock. Like, you could always expect him to come up big in a big moment. This year, again, turned completely into a pumpkin.
Yeah, so I'll tell you what, I'm punching it up right now to see where the Red Sox rank in offensive catcher.
He stinks
because,
this year.
Yeah, he's had a bad year. They're 10th in the league. Okay, they're 10th in the league. But I would tell you in the same breath that I don't think many teams do get great offensive catcher. Okay, Detroit, oddly enough, is one of them. Detroit, they have that rookie, right? Is he the kid that catches there? Anyway, I'll check that in a minute. But regardless, Vasquez has been a disappointment. I would agree with that. I will also tell you that they didn't want him to hit home runs this year for some reason. I think
so. They've ruined him too then?
Well, no.
So it's probably got him all gummed up in the head.
So I think maybe that's it, Murray. I wouldn't rule that out either. It's a good point by you. But I don't think that Vasquez is the reason that their offense is dying. I go back to the big guys in the middle of the lineup. And so if you're relying on your catcher for offense, you're probably not very good because most teams don't get it. And I don't want to say that it's a bonus because I think a lot of the championship caliber teams do get some offense from catcher. And Vasquez is a part of it. He's a part of it. But I don't think it's the number one reason why they're having the difficulty. First base is a different story. Dahlbeck's been useless. Brad's in Northboro. Go ahead, Brad.
Yeah, Tony. First off, I mean, I'm 40 years old. I've lost faith in ownership a long, long time ago. And Liverpool's their baby, and I think they just looked at this year as, you know, all the projections in April, fourth place. So we've already overachieved. And I just don't see us beating Dodgers, Padres, Giants, White Sox, despite Tony La Russa, and the Astros. I mean, it's disappointing.
Okay, so Brad, if you don't see them beating those teams, then isn't ownership doing the right thing?
The Rizzo thing's really killing me. It's really eating at me. I don't think we had to give up too much and get Rizzo. Rizzo was the key, and I knew once he came out here on the East Coast that he was going to be revived, and it's just absolutely eating at me.
Yeah, so that I'm sorry. I thought you were done. I'm sorry. I felt the same way about Rizzo. Get him out of the Cubs. Get him out of Chicago. He was going to leave there anyway. Put him in a race, and he'd get a jolt. He'd get a jolt. I felt the same way. And look, you're not wrong to be agitated about ownership. I get it. I thought there was a happy medium in there. I did not expect Jose Barrios. I did not expect Max Scherzer. I did expect them to reward a team and invest in a team that had played above its ceiling. And that's really what they did. That had exceeded any realistic expectations. In fact, even the wildest expectations. Jimmy Stewart, our producer, said that he thought the Red Sox were going to win the division and win 93 games. They were on pace for 100 wins for a good chunk of the first half. Over 100. And the team didn't reward them. So again, how can they look at you as a fan with a straight face and ask you to invest and believe when they don't? Ray and Revere, go.
Yeah, Ray. Tony, I'm glad you're saying that because that's been my mindset for several years. I treat this team exactly the way the owner treats me. I'll check in August if he steps up and invests. You know, it's 163-hour games. You know, 10 times more of a commitment than football. And, you know, we pay the highest ticket prices in the game, and we support this team better than any other market, highest market capitalization per capita, okay? From my vantage point, they're going to fall out of this complete race. They will not make the playoffs. And you have to turn up the heat on John Henry. The last time he spoke publicly was when you and Mike beat him up 10 years ago. Okay.
That's not true. He typically does a thing every spring. But go ahead. He hasn't done that in a while either. He didn't do it this year.
Yeah, with the beat writers and he's getting softballs. Okay. I mean, he really hasn't taken the heat. He hides. And you saw what he did over in the UK. He is not a benign, hands-off owner. He has an impact. And in this case, you don't have to make trades. You could have taken on bad contracts strictly. And there's no draft penalty to going over to luxury tax for 1 year. This was a financial decision driven by the owner.
Oh, there's no question. It was totally a financial decision. That's a part that's frustrating.
Yeah, he might be hands-on with Liverpool, but with the Red Sox now, like it just feels like this is just another piece of his portfolio, you know? Like I think there's a general apathy that you get from John Henry towards the Red Sox now.
Yeah, I don't think that that's wrong. And again, he treats it as a business. It's part of his portfolio.
Ray and Revere brings up, you know, when he stormed in with you and Mike 10 years ago. We're a long way away from that.
Oh, gosh, that was a lifetime ago.
He hasn't cared about the Red Sox like that since.
Yeah, so, Murray, this is why people want local ownership. They want people that are invested in the team emotionally and don't just want it as part of a business portfolio. It was one of the big strikes against the Jacobs family, but the Bruins for decades still is. Not as bad as it used to be. And it remains a big strike against Henry and Werner and everyone else in that ownership group. People want local ownership because they don't want you to treat it like a business. They want you emotionally invested. That's what they want because they are. And it doesn't feel like this group is emotionally invested. I would tend to agree with that. Murray's got your headlines here. And when we come back, the guy the Red Sox did get at the deadline, Kyle Schwarber, has made some advancement, could be nearing a rehabilitation assignment. We'll tell you, we'll give you the update on him and tell you what Alex Cora said when we come back.
Boom Boom Games, your home for 80s and 90s retro video games, wrestling figures and collectibles, vintage toys, cards, comics, and all your nostalgia needs. They've got something for every console, from Atari 2600 to the PS5 and Xbox Series X. Looking for a specific video game? Let them know and they'll try to source it for you. Do you have some old consoles or collectibles? Bring them in, because Boom Boom Games buys and trades. Boom Boom Games is also your store for Star Wars toys, Pokemon, and the wrestling section will have you feeling that sweet chin music. Boom Boom Games in Billerica. Check them out.
From breaking news.
What are we doing?
To breaking balls.
They all move slow now and they all just want to play softball.
This is the Baseball Hour with Tony Mass on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Alex, it looked like Kyle was running the bases today and did more work at first base. Any progress with that, do you feel?
Yeah, that was what Nielsen just asked me. He ran the bases well. He took ground balls. I think you were here for that one.
Yeah.
So we'll see how he feels afterwards. And then we'll keep building up, you know, that was part of the running progression, which is important for him, you know, and as soon as we can pass that hurdle, then we'll decide what we're going to do with him.
You got that, folks? Kyle Schwarber's running the bases now. Isn't that great? Pretty soon, he'll actually be playing in minor league games. Eventually, he'll be on the field for the Red Sox. In a real game, who knows what the deficit will be in the division by then, or how close the Yankees or the Blue Jays will be. Kyle Schwarber, woohoo! Breaking news sounder, Billy. Kyle Schwarber running the bases. Here we go!
They trying him out at first yet? Can he field a ground ball? We know the guy can hit. He was raking before that injury. Just, what do you have, like close to 30 home runs, I think it was, or something ridiculous.
25, I think.
Yeah. Can he field a ground ball?
Yeah. Like,
that's the more important question right now.
So he's taking grounders over there, Murray, but we'll never really know until they actually get into a game. So this is, a major strike against the Red Sox, and part of the reason why they were probably able to get Kyle Schwarber for the cost they did and why he appealed to them, because he's hurt, and he's not going to play right away. So is it getting closer? Yes. You're not going to see him this week. Maybe you see him at some point next. My guess is ideally he would need about 3 games to get back in, to get some timing down before he can get into the lineup in the big leagues. So, but the other thing is he's been out so long that, you know, can you give him 3 games in a row? Or would you give him a game, then a game off, and then another game and 2 more? You know, you understand what I'm saying. So is it actually going to take him 4 or 5 games to play 3? I don't know. Maybe they DH him 1 game. He plays 2 games at first. Who the hell knows? But you're not going to see him anytime soon. Again, that's Cora on Kyle Schwarber. In the meantime, the Red Sox have lost 5 in a row. And Anthony Rizzo, oh, yeah, right, Anthony Rizzo. Forgot the Rizzinator. OPS near 1,400. 2 more hits and another RBI last night. Yankees win big. Rizzo's OPS, again, he's hitting in the high 400s. OPS is over 1,400. He's played 5 games. The Yankees are 4-1. Over that same span, the Red Sox are 0-4. Talk about a horrible start to the post-deadline, and you rarely see it that way in baseball, where literally changes are made at the deadline and teams go in completely opposite directions right away. You almost never see it that way, although I can recount a couple of occasions in Red Sox history where it did. 2019 was one of them, and Jimmy Stewart would remember this. I don't remember it. It might have been 2006. David Wells, 05, 06. The Yankees came in post-All-Star break, a post-trading deadline in August, swept the Red Sox in a 5-game series, and the season was over. It was David Wells was still here. It was one of those years. And Wells threw up his hands in the dugout. Maybe it was 05. Bobby Abreu was on base like every time he came to bat in that series, if anyone remembers it. In any case, back to your calls. Brendan in Easton, go ahead.
Hi, Maz. Love the show. Listened for a long time. But I think a caller said a little while ago, I think Bloom is going to have a problem. I think it's kind of ironic because he cares about the future, looking to build a future. There won't be a future in a little bit if the players on this team feel the organization doesn't feel like investing in them. I mean, you look at Bogarts, Devers, these guys at the core. Like, are they going to feel inclined to stay here if the team isn't going to spend money on them? I mean, they see Garrett Richards roll out there, Erod, who both been bums all year. I just feel like they may feel a little not cared for, and like the team doesn't want them to succeed. So, I feel like Richards is still more worried about the sweat on his arm rather than actually pitching good.
Yeah, forget Richards. Richards is a mental case. He's a head case. That's not going to turn around. Okay, which again, I look at it and say, what was the decision-making process in bringing Garrett Richards here? I reached out to someone I knew during the offseason and said, what's this guy all about? And they said he's a head case. So how was I able to ascertain that or determine that with one phone call, and the Red Sox went just on spin rate? Just on spin rate and velocity. That was it. That's all they went on. Like, that one's kind of annoying. And they did it when they knew that baseball was probably going to do something about the substances. So they brought a mental case into an environment where they knew there would be change in the middle of the year. The guy's been completely cracked ever since then. He was cracking at the beginning, complaining about the weather. Remember that? But now all of a sudden they get into once the substance issue came to the forefront, the guy completely broke down. He hasn't been the same since.
I mentioned it earlier during Felger and Maz. It's just, you know, you ultimately put this on Bloom and the nerds, too, who were obsessed with his spin rate and whatever the hell specific things that they were looking at statistically, and they didn't look up at the makeup of someone like Garrett Richards, because someone like that does not belong in a rabid city like this where people care maybe a little bit too much. We knew it from the first start, Maz, when he was complaining about the weather, and, oh, I should have brought a coat. This guy's not built for this place.
Yeah, Murray, honestly, like, and I've reached the point where Boston isn't what it used to be. How about just any market that really wants to win? I don't think he's a guy that can pitch in any market that really wants to win. And typically those are the ones that spend.
Yeah, a market where it matters.
Yes.
Yeah, because, again, it's definitely not as rabid as it used to be. But, no, it does matter here, and there is going to be pressure on you. This isn't San Diego where he once was. And so, you know, it's shame on them for not looking at the mental makeup of a player like this.
What a disaster. I mean, this guy
he stinks.
Talk about a bad fit. John in a car quickly on Sox ownership. Go.
Hey, how's it going, guys? John, first time caller. Just a quick question. The fact that LeBron James is not my only owner, do you think that had anything to do with their decision-making this year? Because maybe next year they can go to other people who are looking to buy in the team and say, hey, look at the profit we've made. And it's how it worked out for LeBron. Is that something they probably undertook this season?
Yeah, so, John, look, I mean, I'm all for connecting all kinds of dots. I honestly think it's a 0.0. I mean, I think you'll always find people who want to invest in the Red Sox. I think it was more important for them to get LeBron James in than it was for him to get a part of the Red Sox. Just my two cents. Murray, I don't know how you feel about that, but I don't think it has anything to do with their decision-making process in terms of expenditures. I mean, depending on how much he has invested, he gets a say. But at the end of the day, Henry's making the call. Dan's in Medford. Quickly, Dan.
Hey, so I don't really have much of a take, but, like, as, like, a Red Sox fan, like an average Red Sox fan, how can you show this new ownership group our stamp of disapproval? Or, like, not making any trade, like Xander Bogaerts can't be happy about this. I don't know, like.
Yeah, so look, again, I mean, as a fan, you ultimately, what you hold is your attention. And when I say what you hold, the card you can play is your attention, your interest. And what most franchises do is the fact that you care about the sport, that are passionate about the sport and the team, they use that against you because they know you can't give it up. They almost treat you like an addict. And they say, you want what we have. And we know you're going to be there no matter what. So they exploit you. At the end of the day, that's what they do. We don't look at it that way because you're getting something you enjoy out of it. So it's fine. It's a business deal. They provide the product. You get the entertainment value. And, you know, Murray will give you all types of psychoanalysis. He's better at it than I am in terms of living vicariously through the players on the field, all of that. There's a reason why pro sports are insanely popular in this country and in this city. All of which I'm fine with, but you'd like to think that when it comes to it, that because the team has overachieved and given you something and you've given them something back, that the club would also invest in it and commit to it. That's the one that's hard to swallow. They want you to believe. They want you to invest. particularly coming off a bad 2019, especially in the second half, and the disaster, the absolute unmitigated sports disaster that was 2020. They wanted you to come back and buy in, and you did, and their players did. But when it came time to invest in the team at the deadline, they wouldn't, and they didn't. That part is really inexcusable. It's insulting is what it is. It's insulting as a fan. It's insulting as a follower. You should be pissed. The only potential saving grace here for you is that they snap out of it. They end up becoming what they've been for the majority of the first half. They make the playoffs, maybe even win the division, make a little run, and Chris Sale's healthy and leads them there. In which case, you look at it and say, either they were right or they were lucky. Spencer and Danvers, quickly, go ahead.
Hi, big Liverpool fan. I check in with the Red Sox from time to time, but us Liverpool fans aren't very happy about the lack of investment from FSG. It's always a buy to sell to buy, and it seems like with this recent news from the Red Sox of no investment into the team, even when they're doing well, are FSG fit to be owners of these huge teams? I don't think so.
Well, so look, Spencer, you're not the only one that feels that, and you didn't even bring up the whole Super League fiasco, of which Henry was a big part. There was that whole thing.
He was one of the driving forces behind it.
Absolutely. What a mess that was. What a mess that was. But honestly, I don't follow Liverpool that closely, and I'm not telling you you shouldn't have a similar opinion or you shouldn't follow it. So it's hard for me to connect the dots. And as you know, we try not to cross sports. In this case, it's a little easier because it's the same owner. I just try to treat them all on a case-by-case basis. Overachieving team. Played their asses off. After a year and a half where the team was basically irrelevant, all of a sudden everyone's starting to get interested again. And they do nothing. If it's good business, it's horrible PR. Horrible. And I don't know how you don't have a bad taste in your mouth, especially when Anthony Rizzo is ripping it up in New York in his first week there. We'll wrap it up with your calls. I do want to touch on Jerry Remy. I also want to read you a fabulous email that I received during the show tonight regarding Red Sox ownership. We'll do that when we come back. Wrapping up the Baseball Hour.
This is the Baseball Hour with Tony Mass on Boston's home for sports. 98.5 The Sports. Talking bases on balls.
Huge ones.
It's the Baseball Hour with Tony Mass on your home for Boston sports. 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Is he on your radar as someone who could help you this year?
Nah, I mean, that's something we'll talk about it. But obviously, you know, there's a lot of development, you know, that he has to go through. We got to be realistic. Obviously, you know, the spotlight is on him right now and what he's doing for Team USA. Everybody's going noticing. The games are on TV. The announcers are talking about him, you know, what kind of player he is. So that's why everybody's talking about it. Like I said, we're very proud of him.
Alex Cora talking about Tristan Casas, first baseman who's playing for Team USA, Red Sox best prospect. Apparently, he's ripping it up in the Olympics. I haven't followed really this closely, Murray. Have you?
I only have been following because Jared Carrabas, Barstool Sports, making the usual Tuesday appearance here on the Baseball Hour, keeps putting out clips of him. And yeah, he's been mashing. I think he's up to 4 or 5 home runs already in the tournament, I believe. Oh,
yeah, so look, this guy was at AA, and I think there's a chance he's going to factor in now in spring training in next year. I'm not sure the Red Sox will break camp with him because my guess is that they'll do the Tampa Bay Rays thing and slow his arrival the way they did with Jaron Duran. But we're going to see Tristan Casas at first base next year. So it's just something to keep an eye on. Two quick things before we go. One, how about this email? Murray, you'll like this. Maz and Big Jim.
Yes.
How about a month ago, the Red Sox Twitter account saying that they kept the receipts from all the haters after opening weekend, and now they do nothing at the deadline. Absolute frauds. Love the show. Isn't that a great point?
Yeah, it really is.
It called out all of us.
Like, you didn't believe this team is legit. Like, that's all that was saying. And, like, you know, we mocked that at the time because it's like, okay, it feels like you're playing with fire. They were a fun team. It was easy to get into. The resiliency was real. All of that. Like, okay, enjoy it. Enjoy the ride. But clearly, from an organizational standpoint, you greenlit the fact that you feel like they were legit and they could go on a run. And now how's that turned out for you?
Unbelievable. It really is a great point. And before we leave you tonight, because we have the Revolution coming up next against Nashville, you probably heard by now that Jerry Remy will not be doing the broadcast, taking another leave from Nesson as he battles lung cancer, which he's obviously had a recurrence of. So hang in there, Remdog. Our thoughts go out to Remy. Jerry, I learned a lot of baseball from Jerry over the years. He's a good guy, and we wish him the best. So hang in there. Okay, again, Revs in Nashville coming up next here on 98.5 The Sports Hub. We'll see you tomorrow.
Boom Boom Games, your home for 80s and 90s retro video games, wrestling figures and collectibles, vintage toys, cards, comics, and all your nostalgia needs. They've got something for every console from Atari 2600 to the PS5 and Xbox Series X. Looking for a specific video game? They will try to source it for you. Do you have some old consoles or collectibles? Bring them in, because Boom Boom Games buys and trades. Boom Boom Games is also your store for Star Wars toys, Pokemon, and the wrestling selection will have you feeling that sweet chin music. Boom Boom Games in Billerica. Check them out.